Morning, everybody.
Wow.
I happened to be in the back of the room when the song stopped, so I had to run up front. Sorry about that. Several things happening that I want to call your attention to that are in your bulletin. And there's a couple things that are not in your bulletin. First in the bulletin, we are having a business meeting next Sunday. It'll be immediately following worship. And our goal is to keep it short and sweet. So we would love for you. We've got the revised budget out in the foyer for you, if you're a member, to look over. We'll be voting on that next Sunday. If you have questions, please call myself or one of the elders, and we will be able to answer those questions for you. Our finance team can answer those questions as well, and everybody's names and all that are in your bulletin. So please let us know if you have any questions or things that you want to have resolved before you can vote one way or the other next Sunday. And we also have another elder that we, by God's grace, would love to add to our team, but you all have to vote on him. And so Garrett's information is in the bulletin if you have questions or concerns, and I'm sure many of you have grave concerns about Garrett. So let us know what those are, and we will take him out behind the building and beat him about the head and shoulders. So there's other things happening in here that you'll want to just pay good close attention to. One other thing that I just want to bring up to you: we have been working with our children's ministry. Our children's ministry director we don't have one anymore, and so we've got lots of different things going on, and we have some opportunities that we want to make you aware of. Sometimes we don't get involved in children's ministry because we think, oh, I'm not a teacher, or I've done my duty with my kids. I just don't relate well to children. Well, we have other opportunities for folks who don't want to necessarily work with kids but would like to help. We have bulletin boards that could be decorated. We have supplies that could be purchased and stocked in the classrooms. So we've got other ways that you could be involved if you're interested in being involved in our children's ministry. We really would love for you to prayerfully consider doing that. If you're interested in being involved, the contact card in the pew in front of you would just be a way you could communicate to me about that. Just take the contact card out and write children's ministry and put your contact information in your name, and I will get with you this week and let you know some of those specific things that you can choose from that would be simple that you could do maybe during the week and wouldn't necessarily involve teaching with children. But if you want to teach with children, you want to be involved in the classroom, maybe some of you have done that before, you haven't done it for a while, we also have opportunities there. And we are going to have a training on the 25th of this month, so it's Saturday morning from 9 to 11 a.m., and everyone who would be interested in being involved in the children's ministry can be involved in that with us. So on your contact card, just write training, and we'll know what it is, and let us know that you want to be there, and so we will get in contact with you. I was thinking this morning about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And do you all remember the singer's name, but there was a little bit older, maybe 10 years or so, country song where the girl starts off by singing, the chorus is, "I am Rosemary's granddaughter, the spitting image of my father, and when the day is done, my mom is still my biggest fan," and goes on and talks about who she is, and the title of the song is "Who I Am." And I think God wants you and I to know who you are. Your Father in heaven, if you're one of his children, does not tolerate you. Any parents here sometimes feel like you're just kind of tolerating your children? Your Father in heaven does not tolerate you. Your Father in heaven delights in you. He delights in you. And as we enter into our time of worship today, I want to challenge you to think about that. And as you approach, as the band comes and leads us to the throne of grace, I want you to put a smile in your heart and let that smile translate to your face as you ruminate on the truth that your Father does not tolerate you. Your Father delights in you. if you do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I just want to challenge you to consider, what would it be like to have a Heavenly Father who delights in you? Let's pray together. Thank you, Jesus, that you love us so much that you willingly came to this earth, took our sin on yourself, died in our place, and rose from the dead so that we could have new life, so that we could be the daughters and sons of God like you are the Son of God. You weren't created like we are, but you opened the door so that we could become part of your Father's family. Father, I pray that you would show us how much you love us today. And Spirit, I pray that you would illuminate our minds to understand that our Father delights in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So many of us believe that in order to change our lives, we have to change our behavior. And so we focus on our behavior, and we see some change happen, but the change only happens for a short time. If you're wondering if that's actually true, just think about the vows that you make, the resolutions that you make for the new year. And I don't know about you, but most of those for me don't make it past January 3rd. It's because I'm focusing on my behavior and I'm expecting that my behavior is what's going to change who I am. So we have to ask ourselves, what is it that's really going to make a change in me? And what I'm going to say this week and over the next several weeks is it's not how I behave that's going to make the change in me. It's what I believe. It's what I know to be true, because if something is true, then that truth will impact how I feel and it will impact how I behave, because it's changed me in here and here. The most difficult transition in changing our lives is only 18 inches from our minds to our hearts. And then another, I don't know, for some of us a long distance, for me it's a really short distance, to our hands and our feet and our eyes and our mouths. Change can take place, but we often look for change in the wrong places. We think our behavior is going to do it. We will look to other people, and we will hope that they will encourage us to do it, and they can be great support, but the reality is there's no change unless we understand that what God says about us is what's most important, because God is the source of all truth. And whatever God says about me is what's most important. So this series is going to be all about what God thinks about you and what God thinks about me. Now, the Apostle Paul said something, and I've mentioned this a couple of weeks ago, but he said something that just blew me away. It seemed rather arrogant the first time that I read it many years ago. And maybe you've puzzled over this passage. He said, "I care very little if I'm judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear. But that does not make me innocent." He's not making himself the standard. I'm not innocent because I don't care what you think. I'm not innocent because I don't even care what I think. He says I'm innocent because it is the Lord who judges me. What he's saying to himself, what he's saying to us, and what I believe we each need to say to ourselves is that what God thinks is what matters most. And here's the statement that I would love to just drill into my own heart and soul and yours today. When I believe about myself what God believes about me, I will be changed. Now, what I'm not saying is I'm not going to say in the series is take two verses and call me in the morning. I'm not going to say you memorize a passage and it's going to change you, because many of us have memorized lots of scripture and they're still not active in our lives. It hasn't changed us. But it is the beginning. Now, this new series focuses our attention on what God thinks about you and me. We've been saying for many months now, over a year, that we are a growing community of disciples who make disciples. That's who we want to be. And we have been saying that our discipleship process is very simple, it's very clear, and it's reproducible. We start off by connecting with God and connecting with one another. In order for us to allow Him to change our lives, we have to be personally connected with Him. We have to hear His voice say to us, I delight in you. I don't tolerate you. I delight in you. Sometimes the hardest forgiveness to receive is personal forgiveness. We can read in the scriptures that God says, if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But we don't believe it because we carry the guilt around. You've heard me mention that I meet with a group of men. We're doing a study called Restoring Your Heart, and we're going to be offering some of these groups to anyone else who wants to be involved, and we'll be talking about that in the weeks to come. But one of the things that I had to share with this group was something that I had been carrying around since I was 14. And I knew better. But I didn't believe what God said to me about forgiving me. He'd forgiven me. I'm sure any time I went to God with that and said, please forgive me, He'd be like, what are you talking about? I've already forgiven you. The Psalms say, when you bring your sin to Him, He removes it from Himself as far as the east is from the west. So I need to be more deeply connected with God. I need to hear His voice. That's the first part of our discipleship. We're connected with God and we get connected with other believers. And as we do, the deeper we go in our connection with God, the more in love with Him we are. We see Him for who He is. He's not this vile, mean ogre who's waiting for you to do something wrong so He can thump you. He's a Father who delights in you. And as my love grows in Him, I'm going to grow more spiritually mature because I'll become more like Him. And as I become more like Him, I'll understand the gifts and abilities that God has given me, and I will grow in my maturity so that I serve Him more and more. And as I serve Him more and more, it's going to cause me to be more effective at engaging. Engaging with people around me, engaging our culture, engaging the world. Because that's what we're supposed to do. Because what happens when we engage people? We help them see that they need a connection with God. Because they see it in us. And they want it. And God gives us opportunity to help them get connected and to help them grow in their love and grow in their maturity and engage other people. And that's the process. It's simple. It's clear. It's reproducible. It's something every single one of us can be about. But we will not be about it if it's just something that Pastor Len says. It must be God's truth poured into our minds, in our hearts, and out through our fingertips. So, the series is all about us understanding who we are in God. There's a guy named Sky Jathani. I like saying his name. He wrote a book called With. And the book is really basically all about how we relate to God. And in his book, he kind of lays out four different ways we as followers of Jesus tend to relate with God. Now, I can tell you that I have been in the camp of each of these. Some of these I'm still in right now. So if you see yourself here, you're not alone. But the first one is we relate to God as though we're drawing life from God. Now, to draw life from God, we look to God for everything we want. He's our, if you will, vending machine in the sky. We want God's blessings and His gifts, but we don't necessarily want to have to listen to God. We see God as kind of our WD-40 duct tape pack. He kind of fixes everything we have a problem with, right? That is life from God. All you need to fix just about anything. Then there are some who live life over God. If they ever talk to God, it's basically, God, I got this. No need to sweat over this one, I got it. Now, this person is someone who has turned their back on God and said, I don't need you. That would be an unbeliever. But frankly, some of us believers have done the same thing. We are practical atheists. We talk about living for God, but we don't do it. So this person who is living life over God, they're over God, has nothing whatsoever that they are going to want from Him. There we go, right side up. Then some of us choose to live life for God. We feel like God has come and done some great things in our lives, and so now it's our turn. It's our responsibility now. I'm supposed to show up. I'm supposed to live life for God. It's my turn to expend myself. And this person says something like, pray as though everything depends on God. Work as though everything depends on you. That's what I learned growing up as a brand new believer. That phrase was drilled into my head. And so this person is someone who's going to stand before God, and they're going to know that they deserve being there. They have earned it. They've done everything that they're supposed to. But I want to point out something about this trophy. It could be polished up. This little handle here is loose. This one's fallen off. That's what it is. That's what it's like when we stand before God with our efforts. They will never measure up. And yet some of us continue to live life for God. And then there are others who live life under God. It's basically a simple cause and effect proposition. I obey, I jump through His hoops, and God has to do for me whatever I say. In his book, Jathani gives an example of this one that I think is really appropriate. And I read this one because, frankly, I've been here. And can I tell you a secret? Because I love you. I've heard many of you say the same kinds of things. This is life under God. This was the example of a man named Steve Johnson. He's a wide receiver for the Buffalo Bills. Back in January 28, 2010, the Bills faced off against their rival Pittsburgh Steelers. Steelers fans here? I didn't hear any cheering. The Bills ultimately lost the game, and here's the thing. When Steve Johnson dropped a pass in the end zone during overtime, after the game, via Twitter, Johnson publicly blamed God for the loss. Listen to what he said. And don't judge, because I think you could probably say the same thing. I praise you 24/7, and this is how you do me? You expect me to learn from this? How? I'll never forget this, ever. Now, I don't know where Steve Johnson is at in his relationship with God at this point, but I know where he was then. And I don't say that with an accusatory finger. I know where he was then because I was like, yeah, I've done that. I have lived life under God. Maybe you have too. Maybe you find yourself up here living life from God or over God or for God or under God. But that is not how God wants us to live our lives. Each of those ways of relating to God are fatally flawed. He does not want that for you and me. He came so that we could live life with God. He wants to be deeply, personally, intimately, passionately connected with you and me. Now pause for a moment and think. How connected to God am I? I mean, you think about the deepest relationship you have with anybody. What does a deep connection look like with that person? Is your connection with God at least there? Could it be deeper? Now, remember, this is not life for God, not life from God, not even life under God. It's life with God. And how are we supposed to see that happen? Well, here's the good news. The good news is a connection with God can't be done by you and me. It has to be initiated, and it has to be empowered by God Himself. But the other part of the good news is your Father delights in you, and He wants to be connected with you. It kind of reminds me of the old couple who were driving down the highway in their old Chevy truck with the bench seat. And the old lady, she kind of sitting there with her hand on her chin, and she's looking out the window, and she says, "Honey, we used to be so close." And very astutely, he let the silence hang in the air. And after a couple miles and a few minutes of silence, he said, "Well, I haven't moved." If we are not feeling connected with God, if we are not feeling close to God, it's not because He moved. And that isn't to dump guilt on anybody. That is to just say the reality is your Father loves you and He wants to be with you. Think about how deeply you love that person who you feel the most connected with. You want to be with them. Your Father in heaven wants to be with you. He wants you to know. He wants you to experience. He wants you to feel His delight in you. We can even feel His delight in us when we're going through persecution and difficult times, because we know whom we have believed, and we are convinced that He is able to do all that we ask or think according to His riches in Christ Jesus in whatever situation we find ourselves in. So we're going to start at the very beginning. God's the one who initiates it. And it starts with Him doing a creative work in us. In your Bible, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, we're going to focus on this one verse today. So you may want to turn in the Bible to 2 Corinthians 5:17. If you're using one of the pew Bibles, like I will be, you will be turning to page 805. Chapter 5, verse 17, we read this. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here." There's several different translations of this, but the basic idea is that when anyone is in Christ, God is doing a new creative work in that person. All the old has gone away and the new has come. What he's basically saying is, He is doing something different in you. This little statement is so filled with theology and a depth of understanding who God is, that when we believe what's said in here, He will transform us. But He will only transform us when we believe it. When we know that it is true, when we will hold on to the Scriptures over everything else. Because here's the thing. The Scriptures will tell us one thing. Our friends will tell us something else. The culture around us will tell us something else. Our parents will tell us something else. our spouse, what we watch on TV, what we read in literature may tell us something different. The question we have to resolve for ourselves is, will I believe God above everybody else? He says for us that we are new creations in Christ. I want to take that little bitty phrase, in Christ, and unpack it for just a moment. What does it mean to be in Christ? In Christ is one of Paul's favorite phrases. He uses it 86 times in his 13 letters. If you were to take the phrases in the Lord and in Him and add those to in Christ, it would be 164 occurrences in 13 short letters. It can be a difficult theological term to understand because it's used in lots of different ways, but mostly it's used in one specific way for us that we need to drill down on today. An author and pastor, John R.W. Stott, I think summarizes what it means to be in Christ really well. And listen carefully, because you may feel like the first way he describes to be in Christ is how you've thought about it. But listen carefully to what Jesus is trying to communicate to you and to me when he says that you are in Christ. This is true of you. To be in Christ does not mean to be inside Christ, as tools are in a box or clothes are in a closet, but to be organically united with Christ. As a limb is to the body of a tree, as a limb is in the body or a branch is in the tree, it is this personal relationship with Christ that is the distinctive mark of his authentic followers. When you and I put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, he becomes our Savior. We are united with him. We are then in Christ now and forever. We are in Christ. Now, I don't make that statement lightly. There are some who say that if you are in Christ, that you can never lose your salvation, and I'm one of those people. However, what I don't mean when I say that is, I can make a profession of faith, I can get my fire insurance policy, and then I can live like I want. Because, remember, what I believe changes my behavior and transforms my life. So when Jesus comes into me, I'm no longer my own, I'm his. And he changes me from the inside out. So what I believe changes my behavior and transforms my life. That's what it means to be in Christ. This new connection with Christ brings about a totally new person. A person who did not exist before. Verse 15 of 1 Corinthians 15 says this, "And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again." He died for you so that you would live for him. Galatians 2:20 reads this way, "I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me." Now stop for a minute. Christ lives in me. Help me out. Somebody shout out for me. What does it mean that Christ lives in me? Holy Spirit resides inside of me, teaching me. What else does it mean? Christ lives in me. He's in your heart, okay? What else? Okay? You demonstrate his teachings by your actions and attitude. It should be that if somebody sees me acting and interacting and living my life, should it be that they see less of me and more of Jesus? Remember what John the Baptist said? And I think this is a great summary for how we should want to live our lives. I must decrease, he must increase. So even though this passage is really clear that this new trend, new creation is now, you are a new creation, there are other passages that explain that the process that we go through is a progressive creation. The word that's used is a progressive sanctification. We become more and more like Jesus. For me to live as Christ and to die is gain. I'm no longer living, but Christ in me, the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. To be in Christ comes about when by faith I exchange his death for mine. I exchange my life for his. The outcome is a new me. It's a new life. It's a new way of relating to the world. Because now I see myself as a follower of Jesus. I'm a disciple. And what do I want to do? I want to connect with God better, deeper, so that I love him more and I grow in my maturity and I engage the world. Why? So that other people see the same thing I do. And they come to know God. And he radically changes them so that they, as disciples, become part of the community, the global community of disciples who make disciples. That is what we are all about. Jesus gave his life, and here is a passage that summarizes it all, so that we don't live life for God, under God, from God, over God, but we live life with God. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Do you live your life with God? So the person who is in Christ lives with Jesus as a new creation. God has been the creator from the beginning. He created everything that is, but he's not done creating. He's continuing to work on you and me. And the word new there is really kind of cool. There's a couple different words that can be used for new. This particular word focuses on something that is brand new, has never been in existence before. Now, here's an example that might kind of drive this meaning home. After Jesus taught and he cast out a demon in the Gospel of Mark, this is what the people said, and here's the same word used for new. What is this? A new teaching? Same word. A new teaching and with authority. He even gives order to impure spirits and they obey it. This is something they had never, ever seen before. Something no one else had ever been able to do. You are someone that no one else has ever seen before. Think about this. You are God's unique creation. Did you catch yourself looking in the mirror this morning and saying, "Wow, that, yow. Yeah, I don't like what I saw there." Now, I don't mean you had a blemish, you got to take care of it, right? What do you think about you? Your Father wants to do life with you. He cares about you, and you are a brand new creation that has never existed. You don't need to be like me. You don't need to be like somebody else. You don't need to. I remember, any of you recognize the name Chuck Swindoll? Right? He's on the radio, right? Big name preacher. Chuck Swindoll taught me this lesson in two different ways. First of all, he told the story on himself. He said, when I was first in ministry, I wanted to be like everybody else. And he listed off the different speakers of his day whom none of us would recognize, and so I'm not going to bother. And he said, I tried to be like them, and I just stumbled and fumbled, and I couldn't do it. And then one of my mentors said to me, Chuck, just be yourself. And I, for one, am glad that he listened, because I gained a lot from his ministry. And then Chuck taught me the lesson personally. When I was at Dallas Seminary, where Chuck Swindoll went to school, he came as a speaker. And I've never been much of a fan, you know, those kind of people that would chase after a celebrity, get their autograph. But I'm standing in the parking lot, minding my own business, watching over all these cars that were there for the people who came to hear Chuck Swindoll speak that night. And as I'm standing there, I notice out of the corner of my eye, somebody's coming. And I see that it's Chuck Swindoll. And I don't know what came over me. I'm like, I found my little pocket New Testament and I got it out. And I walked up to Chuck and I said, "Will you sign my Bible?" I feel like an idiot even now telling it. And he says to me, "So what's your name?" And he didn't really say much of anything to me beyond that. He handed me my Bible and I put it in my pocket. And I waited till he was out of eyesight in his car driving down the street before I quickly grabbed it up. I looked at it. He wrote Len Billings. He didn't want anyone thinking that he was anything more than just a servant of God. And the most important thing for us to know is that we are valuable for who we are, not because of anything we have done, and not because other people think we're somebody. You are a creation that has never existed before. Now, nothing in the Bible was written in a vacuum. One of the most important principles of good Bible study I learned from, and I'm going to teach you today from one of my profs in seminary, Daryl Bach. He taught us what he called the exegete's cheer. Now, this is one of the most important things that you can know for Bible study, okay? Now, exegesis is a very important thing for us to practice, but sometimes we practice a thing called eisegesis. Eisegesis, the small little preposition there, eis, in Greek means into. And so when you are doing eisegesis, you're looking at a passage and you're forcing your meaning into it. You've probably heard sermons like that. If you hear me doing a sermon like that, please confront me, because that's not the way we should do preaching, and that's not the way we should study the Bible. We don't want to be eisegetes. Instead, we want to be exegetes, and an exegete, or exegesis, is where we draw the true meaning out of the passage. We let God speak to us through the passage and tell us what he's trying to say, instead of me trying to tell him what he ought to be trying to say. Okay? So here is the exegete's cheer. And this, if you get this down, your Bible study will be even more fruitful. Okay, you ready? Can you say the word context? Context. Ready? We got to say it three times. Ready? Context, context, context. If you want to understand a passage, you must understand the context within which it is written. Now, this passage is written within a little bit larger context of the whole chapter than the entire book of 2 Corinthians. Now, the nearer but little further out context is between the book of 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. And then historically, we know there's at least one letter that isn't part of the inspired word of God that was written between 1 and 2 Corinthians. So calling it 2 Corinthians, well, not really, because there was at least one letter in between. God chose not to save that. But this is also within the context of all 13 of Paul's letters. And then you add 14 more, you have the whole Old New Testament. And then we see it in the context of the whole Bible, all 66 books. So as I was thinking about this passage, it struck me that this sounds strangely familiar to a passage that I had seen in Isaiah. And I think that Paul is unpacking this passage. He's actually showing that there's a fulfillment going on in our lives from this passage in Isaiah chapter 43. And here's how it reads. "Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past." Get that. Forget the former things. Don't dwell on the past. "I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. He's saying, don't focus on the old. Don't dwell on that. Instead, focus on the new. And what God is telling us is that the old is gone, the new has come in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Like Israel, we were in rebellion against God, living that old life, living that wasted life, turning our backs on Him, being over Him. But when we come to Jesus by faith, He gives us a new life. The old way of life is gone. A new way of life has come. And the question we have to wrestle with is, am I living in that new life? Or am I lugging the old life around with me? We came to Jesus by faith and He made us new. Are we living in the newness of who He is and what He's done? What makes this such great news, is we are not a new creation because of our effort. This is all of God's effort. And He wants us to realize that He doesn't want us to dwell on the things of our past. I already mentioned to you that, you know, I meet with this group of guys, and I had to confess something recently that I've been lugging around since I was 14. I don't want to do the math and realize that that's 40 years. How long have you been lugging around your guilt? Do you think it's time to live in the freedom that God has given you? Paul says this in verse 16 of the same chapter we're in. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. We don't look at somebody's past. We look at who God wants to make them. You think about helping people make a connection with God. We sometimes look at human beings and we think, well, there's no way that person's coming to Jesus. No. He's saying, just as I did the creative work in you, I can do it in them. I can radically change them from the inside out. Completely. But if you don't believe it's true for you, you're not going to believe it's true for them. Now, I have been guilty of saying, you know, I believe this is true of you, but I don't see it for me. But really, one of my study mates last week said, you know, if you don't believe God, there's a problem here. If you're not feeling that change, if you're not seeing that change, maybe it's because you don't really believe Him. Now, I want to be careful here. I'm not saying, as some say, that if God doesn't heal you, it's because you don't have enough faith. I'm not saying that. We're talking about apples and oranges here. What I am talking about is knowing who you are in Jesus. If you're struggling with something like that and saying that, you know, I've asked God to do this and He's not healed me, He's what? You're living life from God. You're expecting that if you put your quarter in, you're going to get your gumball. If you're doing that, then He's not God. I've been there. And I don't think God wants us to stay there. In order for my behavior to change, I need to be grasped a hold of by the truth. So now maybe we are ready to hear what I started with fresh ears. Paul said, I care very little if I am judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear. But that does not make me innocent. Who makes me innocent? Who tells me I'm valued? Who tells me I'm okay? It is God who judges me. When I believe about myself what God believes about me, I will be changed. What Paul tells us is that the old, antiquated, archaic, worn-out way of thinking about myself has passed out of existence. It's dead. It's gone. And a new me has taken its place. And the new creation results in new behavior. Now let's be really careful here. I did not create this new creation, God did. I cannot create this new behavior, God does. When God's word is believed by me, the Holy Spirit empowers that and begins to drill it down into my heart and soul and changes my life. I can't do it. You can't do it. Only God can do it. Jesus said, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples." Now think about that in light of what we've been saying. This is our simple, clear, reproducible discipleship process. It starts with us connecting with God. And it starts with us remaining with God. In other words, we know what His Word says, and we allow His Word to be what guides us. The Holy Spirit illuminating or shining His light on it so that we can understand it and so that we can then choose to obey it. And when we do, He changes our behavior. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Anybody here want to be free? Anybody here feel like you're in bondage? Could it be that you don't really believe? That's what it means to know. To know means to have some intimate personal knowledge of the truth. Could it be that you don't really believe the truth? Now, I'll say it again. We're not talking about I'm praying and God is going to give me what I want. Okay? We're talking about something God wants to give you. He delights in you. He wants you to know who you are. He wants you to know what puts a smile on His face. He will give you that. He already has. We just have to access it. The truth will set you free. The truth will change you from the inside out. The truth will help you know who you are in Christ. So, we abide, we hold on to, we believe God's word, and it will set us free. Free from the sin that we constantly struggle with. Free from the depression that's got us down. Free from looking in the mirror and not liking what we see. Free from the chains of other people's judgment. Maybe you're going through a time where your character is being impugned. I want you to know that Jesus, Isaiah tells us, was a man of no reputation. His reputation was trashed. They told all kinds of lies about him. But even though his reputation could be besmirched, his integrity could not be touched. Your reputation, if you choose to follow Jesus, will be besmirched. It will happen. But nobody can touch your integrity unless you give it away. And your Father is the only one whose opinion matters. You stand before Him with integrity, nothing else matters. You can have a smile in your face, even if people are throwing daggers at you. It does not matter. When you are in Christ, you are a new creation. Now, I want to spend the last moments that we have together, and I want to walk through some things that are true of you because you are in Christ. Remember, Paul uses this phrase, in Christ, 86 times. 86 times. So I'm just giving you a handful of things that are true of you and me because we're in Christ. And let me ask you this question as you listen to these. How would it change somebody's life if they felt this truth? If they knew that it were true, how would it change the way you see yourself in the mirror? The way you interact with other people, the way you feel about who you are, the way you receive the words that others throw your way. In Christ Jesus, you were given grace before the world was created. You were given God's favor. He smiled with you with favor before the world was created. He gave us grace in Christ Jesus before the ages began, 2 Timothy 1:9 says. In Christ, you were chosen by God before creation. Ephesians 1:4 says, God chose us before the foundation of the world. He looked across all of those who would be created and he'd say, I want Vicky. She's mine. I want Nathan. He's mine. He's mine. Every single one of us who put our faith and trust in Christ, he chose us before anything was created. In Christ, you are loved by God with an inseparable love. Inseparable. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate you. Nothing. Now, notice, it does not say that you won't go through difficult times. I mean, it kind of talks about death. Something we're all going to experience. But that is not a separation from God. For the believer, as we've said over and over, death is not a tragedy, it's an upgrade. Now, none of us really want to go through that, right? But that is truth that will change your life. In Christ, you were redeemed and forgiven, here, listen to this, for all your sins. For all your sins. Ephesians 1:7 says, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. How many of your sins were future when Christ died for you? All of them. Now remember, it doesn't mean I get my fire insurance, I get to be in Christ, and then I live like I want. If that's you, and you've had that attitude, you probably, I'll say it this way, this? We there? Woo-hoo! We have been having all kinds of issues with our sound system, and these guys, the guys that run it, do a fabulous job for us. So this is not any of their doing or fault or anything. Thank you, Andrew. Okay. You are redeemed and forgiven for all your sins. In Christ, you're justified before God, and the righteousness of God in Christ is imputed. Big, huge theological term just basically means it's treated as though it's yours. It's given to you. Is imputed to you. Jesus' righteousness, when God sees you, he does not see all the past. The old is gone. You are new because he sees you through the righteousness of Jesus, and here's the passage that says that. For our sake, God made Christ to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Your Father sees you as the righteousness of God. In Christ, everything you need is yours. Philippians 4:19 says, my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Everything you need. In Christ, the peace of God guards your hearts and your minds. Philippians 4:7, the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. A couple more. In Christ, you have eternal life. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Christ you have become a new creation. If anyone's in Christ, he or she is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, everything has become new. Don't live life from God. Don't live another second over God. Don't fool yourself thinking that you're going to live another minute for God. And do not live another second of your life under God. Instead, live your life with God. Let Him be in control. Let Him change how you see yourself. Let the old go. It's past. Live in the new. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for the truth, because it will set us free. And God, many of us for many years have had some truth that we haven't quite been able to grasp. And I know for me, even last week, there was something I was holding on to that I did not realize was holding me back from when I was 14. Lord, I pray that you will work in each and every one of our lives and remind us that the past is gone and we live in the new. Thank you for the new creation you've made us. Help us to walk in that. In Jesus' name.